Thank you guys for watching the Animal One Guy YouTube videos. If you like this video, please leave a like and even comment below. And if you like all my content, please hit the subscribe button. And why not click the bell icon for notifications too? That way you can see all my videos. Give me the ball. So here's gonna be a little, just a little series that I do in a video. Does it have anything to do with this? No, it doesn't. But it does have to do with my trip to PetSmart. We're gonna be looking at these. That's right. So PetSmart, when I was there, if you watch that video back, last video, and you know, I picked up one of each of their guides, they call it the Getting to Know Your. And I guess this is gonna be the Getting to Your Know Your PetSmart Care Guides series, and we're gonna break them down. And why don't we start with one of the most popular. Interesting, I just saw this one and I'm like, oh, there's a Chinese water dragon. But wait, they have one on Chinese water dragons. Well, this is just like setting up a reptile habitat. But we'll look into that. We'll go through and we'll always pick one random one, so don't have to worry about that. But we're gonna start with a popular one at the beginning, and it's gonna be the Getting to Know Your Bearded Dragon from PetSmart. Now, these have been reviewed before in the past, but PetSmart supposedly redid these, updated these, made these better. There is a copyright of 2020 at the back of this. So, okay, let's hope so. I do want to point out one other thing, and you know, PetSmart, if people say, well, PetSmart's just a pet store, you know, they're not a vet, they're not the super expert, they're just a distributor, you know, they're just a retailer. That's true, although they are an animal retailer who retails with these. But at the bottom here, developed and approved by PetSmart veterinarians. So I'm not sure what this means. Does this mean PetSmart has veterinarians that are veterinarians and work directly for PetSmart? Are these just veterinarians that PetSmart paid a consulting fee? I don't know. We'll take a look at this thing front and back. But okay, so like with all their series, they put the Getting to Know Your, and then in all capital, this is all lowercase, and then in all capitals, the name of the reptile, a really big dramatic picture of the reptile where they make it look big even if it is small, and then this bottom part. So this is all the same. And they're all the same little pamphlet that just opens up and has its internal pages. And I will tell you, if you look at this from the outside, not as a reptile person, this does make things seem kind of easy. And it's interesting to me because they do list things in terms of difficulty. But I did do a brief look on some other ones. So other reptiles do have like different difficulties, and the pictures of the enclosure, the tank kind of looks the same, they do, and the top may look the same, but you know, they do put different stuff on the inside. So that's one thing I wanted to verify that if they had pictures, they're not using the same pictures, and they're not. Okay, good. Look, there's also a little bearded dragon here. So how do we do this? How did they do it, I guess, is the thing. So inside each one, you're going to get the name of the lizard, but you're also going to get something in some black text above it. Like, these are cold-blooded and so cool. You're going to get like a little cool thing, and it is a little bit different, and it goes towards it. But so bearded dragons, their beards are actually the spiny skin under the throat that puffs up when they're excited or frightened. Yeah, or just any, I mean, you know, these are basic, guys, so I don't think these are saying they're the only time, but excited, frightened, mad, you know, basically whenever they're in a high emotions mode. This lists it as experience level as beginner. I would say, yeah, bearded dragons can grow up to 24 inches. That's 61 centimeters. That's 2 feet for all of you that surprised. You can actually, this is a little bit interesting, but they can get larger than this, especially German giants, but approximately. So this is a good, this is a good reference number. I'll go with that. So far, we're doing good. Beginner, I do believe they're beginner, and actually I believe most reptiles, honestly, are beginner, and that most of the time the hard part is just getting a big enough enclosure and setting it up correctly. So I would say that, yes, this is beginner. Lifespan. Bearded dragons can live approximately up to 10 years. This is so wrong. Oh my goodness. This is so wrong. No. Bearded dragons can live approximately way longer than 10 years. Even in the wild, they can live longer than this. This could be one of the major reasons why people are like, my bearded dragon lived till 6 years old. It lived a good life. Or it lived till eight. It was a great life. Heck no. They can live into their mid-20s, people. This is wrong. This is a horrible statement. And any type of vet that says you should expect a 10-year lifespan is just wrong. Lying. If you give them bad care, maybe, but that's wrong. Behavior. Bearded dragons are friendly. Okay, yeah. And are known to communicate with one another through waves and head bobbing. Okay. Through one another. So they're talking about how they behave not with towards you, the human. Like, I guess I don't even know why they talk about how bearded dragons, which should be a solitary lizard, although you can do male female and but you can especially easier do female female in a correct enclosure. I'm not sure what this has to do with it, but yeah, most of the time they are friendly, and they should be say they are known to communicate with their owner, you know, through head bobs, which they can do, but normally head bobbing is a dominance thing. So, and the speed of the head bob is what's important. Bearded dragon terrarium. Before we even look at what everything is, what do we see here? Water bowl, some type of humidistat, thermostat. It's probably, that's a combo. Another, that could be either or. Some fake foliage. Oh no. Okay, I don't know what's to eat in here. I hope it's not like bearded dragon food. But I'm going to tell you, I'm going to point out right away, this has got to be reptile carpet or substrate. Both of which are bad. The first is worse though. So A, the terrarium. Okay, yeah, I guess that's right. B, the lid. Oh, okay, I think we're a little bit, okay. UVV bulb and fixture. Okay, yeah, this probably got a compact fluorescent sideways, and this is the reflector. That's fine. This is a small terrarium here, I'm guessing. Otherwise, this is not going to be giving out enough UVB. Typically, you'd want an 18-inch, 12% T5 high-output bulb or a mercury vapor bulb in place of this. D, basking bulb and lamp. Okay, so there, I guess they're counting the dome as the lamp. That's fine. Yep, and there's a bulb. We'll just assume there's a bulb in there, like in there. E, thermometer. Yep, yep, okay. F, reptile carpet. Oh, no. What vet approved reptile carpet? That is a death. That's why you get 10 years, and you're lucky if you get that with that. Unless you have a reptile carpet. Okay, you know how you can do reptile carpet, guys? Is literally every time the bearded dragon poops or pees on it, you take everything out of the enclosure, you remove this reptile carpet, you wash this, you put it in the laundry, you put it in the dishwasher, you have to do a thorough sanitation of it to kill any type of bacteria, especially coccidia. And while that's through its wash, you do one of two things. You leave the bearded dragon out, you leave it empty, or you put in a replacement reptile carpet. I do see people who use reptile carpet, they do say, oh, I have three or four and I rotate them every time the thing poops. You're taking all this out every time? No, bad. That's horrible. That was F. Where are we at now? Food dish? Okay, that's fine. Water dish, big enough for pet to soak in. I do believe in giving bearded dragons water bowls that are big enough for them to lay in. If you go and you watch Johnny Cage, he loves to splash, he loves to lay, sleep, soak, and drink from his water bowl. Is it needed for the life of the bearded dragon? No. They can get enough water from misting on the vegetables that they eat and from the bugs that they eat internally, and just and that's fine. This is also another thing you have to clean, though. I have to clean his all the time, but it's easy to clean a water bowl. I take it to the sink, wash it, disinfect it, put it in, fill it up. So that's okay. That's enrichment that I believe in, though. Now, after the water dish, the hygrometer thermostat, yeah, combo. This is interesting, though. I will tell you that, obviously they want to sell stuff. So this is like the ZoomEd one or whatever. These are the exact, like, they even look exactly like the stuff that they sell. But that's okay. Yeah, you should be measuring the humidity. So that's fine. Plants and decor. Yeah, the only thing that they do here is they don't call out if these are real or if these are fake. When you see plants and decor. And then K is a basking site beneath the heat lamp. Yeah, that's fine. That's good. Obviously you'll change out that basking site as the bearded dragon gets larger. It could bask on here, but that's all good. Let us look at the next part. So then underneath their breakdown. So normally all of them have this. Then, these pamphlets all follow the same thing. Then we're going to talk about the terrarium. We're going to take a picture of it. You're going to get a little thing. Okay. And then underneath, you're going to get basically the times and the temperatures that you should have in the gradient. So if this information is correct, this and this up here, this is not correct. But if these pamphlets were 100% correct, to have it broken down like this is great. It really could be your entry level one-stop shop. So terrarium, there's a target range, and then they break down basically the time range. So you got the day temperatures of the cool side, and then they call it a basking spot. I guess that incorporates the warm side, the night temperature, and the humidity. Okay, so let's see what it says. This is the key. So day temperature on the cool side, 75 to 85. Okay, that's a pretty big target range of this 10 degree. And there's your Celsius, by the way, for everyone who's on metrics. That's fine. Day temperature for basking, okay. Night temperature is absolutely fine. And humidity is fine. These are ranges. If I wanted to get super nitpicky, I would say, yeah, like 20 to 25% is target humidity, personally. Nighttime temperature can drop actually quite a bit cooler. It can drop into the mid-50s, but that's okay. That's a fine temp. I like to tell people room temperature 68 degrees is really good. No night heated needed at all, as long as you have a you're not getting super cold in the winter. If you've got whole home heat and you're let it cool down to 63, 64, 62 even at night, that's just fine for your bearded dragon. It's okay. Day temperature of the basking spot and the day temperature of the cool side. I think this cool side at 85 is a little warm. It should probably be between 70 and 75 on the cool side. The basking spot temperature is very interesting because not necessarily that this is wrong, although this could be considered a little on the high side. The thing is, you have to look at your bearded dragon. Typically, a safe basking spot for a bearded dragon is between 85 and 100 degrees. But what does that mean, that 85 to 100? Because even here it has a range. You have to look at your dragon. So Mongo, being an older bearded dragon, and most people who have older bearded dragons, they'll tell you they do not like super hot basking. He prefers to bask around 90, 91 degrees. Any hotter, and he stays away from the basking spot. Then there's other dragons, Johnny Cage, who cannot get enough of his heat. If I don't turn up his heat, if he doesn't sit around 98, 100 degrees, he tries to get as close as possible to the basking bulb to bask. He's crazy. So you should have that range, but I consider this high to be the minimum that they're recommending. And having multiple bearded dragons, they prefer basking at completely different temperatures. And you can tell how your bearded dragon prefers to bask. If they get closer and closer to the bulb, they like it hotter and hotter. So heat it up more. That way they don't have to get as close. If you find them not basking a lot, like they hang out on the cool side, they bask a little bit, they run back to the cool side, that basking spot is too hot. How do I set up a bearded dragon terrarium? That's a great question. Oh no. Reptile carpet or tile is best. Remove droppings as needed. Clean at least every other week. Oh, no. Okay, so... damn it, people. Yes, I noticed they do not mention dirt or soil substrate. That is right, PetSmart. 100% correct. You should not have substrate with your bearded dragon. You can do it if it is extremely bioactive. But still, you can lead things to impaction, eye infection, breathing problems, respiratory, etc. Tile is good, especially if you cover the tile. Reptile carpet is horrible. And clean at least every other week. That I'm assuming that's a deep clean. That's horrible. If you're cleaning every other week, so every 2 weeks, and you've got reptile carpet, like you're just picking up the poop, how do you get the liquid pee or the liquid poop out of the carpet, the coccidia bacteria, if you're leaving it in there for 2 weeks? That's horrible. This statement is bad. Horrible. But it's weird because it's like half right because they're telling you not to use substrate. But then every other part about it is wrong. Don't follow this instruction. Bearded dragon terrariums require a temperature gradient, a cool side and a warm side. That's true. Add thermometers and a hygrometer to monitor temperatures and humidity. Mist your bearded dragon daily with warm water. Okay. This part is right. It does. They do need to thermoregulate, so they need to go to hot to cold. This, mist your bearded dragon daily? No. That's horrible. I could only see that if you're living somewhere with literally zero, constant 0% humidity. But if you're in this 20% humidity, guys, do not be misting your bearded dragon, let alone every day. That's horrible advice. Most people's homes humidities in the winter, if you've got a thermos, if you've got a furnace, you typically have a whole home humidifier on it, or you have, you know, cool mist or warm mist humidifiers if you don't have that to keep your skin from drying out in the winter. And in the summer, most places, it's extremely humid and the air conditioning removes humidity, or you have a dehumidifier. You're normally struggling to keep your bearded dragon's humidity low. You would never want to mist it. Reptiles require a 12-hour day-night cycle. Yeah, yeah, 10 to 14 hours. So 12, saying 12 is fine, depending on the reptile. A UVA, UVB bulb will help your bearded dragon absorb calcium. Okay, yeah, I guess. I mean, the UVA part doesn't really have anything to do with it, but that's just the visible spectrum. But yeah, a UVB bulb will help it absorb calcium. A UVB, but this is kind of bad because it says you require a dwave and that this will only help. It doesn't help. The vitamin D3 that they synthesize, the vitamin D from the UVB, is the only way that their bodies can absorb the calcium. Now, you can supplement D3 instead of having UVB bulbs, but where's that listed? Nowhere. And that should only be for an expert. And they don't list that. No, you need to have UVB so they will absorb calcium, not to help them. Add driftwood or a rock to climb a little closer to the heat source. Yeah, that's fine. Add a few branches for hiding and climbing. Yeah, well, this is really more relevant when they're a baby, but I guess this whole thing is about setting it up. So yeah, I would say that this is a fine statement. 100% accurate. You'll end up getting rid of like the small branches to climb when they get older. You give them a hammock that's on an angle. They're perfect. For more information, consult PetSmart Reptiles and Amphibian List. Oh, get that the heck out of here. What should I feed my bearded dragon? Okay, now we're talking. Young bearded dragons are omnivores, approximately 50-50. As they mature, they will eat more vegetables, approximately 90. Okay. This is almost 100% right, but I do love this statement. Yes, when they're older, I like to do the opposite. I like to say you start them 90% insects, 10% vegetation, and as they're getting close to adulthood, you move from 90% veggies to 10% insects. But that might be too hard. It might be too complicated. This is trying to stay basic. So 50-50 is okay. I've seen bearded dragons that don't grow well enough starting at that, but that's okay. And this is correct where they should be when they're adults. And then let's see, what do we have here? Insects. Feed gut-loaded insects, crickets, or dubia roaches. Okay, so they do talk about the more protein, the better of the two. You know, crickets or dubias one time a day. Yeah, that's fine. Mealworms, superworms, are yep, because those are high in fat. So that's fine. Now I potentially see a problem. Dust food with a calcium slash vitamin D3 powder 4 to 5 times a week for juveniles, 2 to 3 times a week for adults. Dust food with a multivitamin 1 time a week, juvenile 2 times a month for adults, or as directed. This is horrible. And I'm going to explain why. And it has a little bit to do with this up here. If you have proper UVB, so your reptile, and it doesn't have to be a bearded dragon, but your reptile is synthesizing enough vitamin D3, because you have a range, and a lot of bearded dragons are on the high end if UVB is done right. If you start supplementing with vitamin D3, especially, I know they're saying it, you do it every time a day as a baby because their bones are growing, but if you synthesize vitamin D3, you run the risk of vitamin D3 overload. And what that's going to do is that's going to oversaturate their cells with vitamin D3, which the reason why that's bad is that's going to then prevent their cells from efficiently absorbing all the other vitamins A, B, C, a whole list of nutrients that they need to absorb because their cells are going to be oversaturated. So if you have proper UVB, and you measure it with a solar meter, or you know the setup and you've done it, and you have the right bulb and the right reflector. If you're using an Arcadia 12% bulb at 10 inches away, or 10 to 12, 10 to 14, you're in the right. Do not use D3. You can use D3 and calcium if you're trying to recover from MBD and help heal MBD over time, which is mostly healable, but not if you're just a normal dragon. That's too much. Dust food with multivitamin 1 week. Yeah, I give multivitamin way more than twice a month, and I live a lot longer. So I wouldn't. That's not enough. You're just doing a light dusting supplement. Vegetables, fresh darky leaves. Yeah. Okay, so carrots offered daily. This is not good. And I wish they would talk about fresh dark leafy greens because you have the potential of offering kale. And you have the potential of offering spinach. And then to call up, squash is fine, peas are also okay, and carrots are not fine. Why? Because if you're feeding in excess the wrong kale can does bind your calcium in your dragon a little bit, making it unabsorbable. Although spinach is the main cause of that, and they should care that. But also, you know what does that? Carrots. And so you can offer carrots as a treat. I've fed them before, people have fed them before, but carrots should not be part of the daily offering. That's very bad for them. Carrots are a good treat, I would say no more than once a week, because they are high in vitamin A and things like that. Well, not naturally vitamin A, but they're high in something that then gets turned into vitamin A, and that's key because raw vitamin A can be bad. Fruits like melon, berries and citrus may be offered once a week. Yeah, that's fine. I try to stay away from the citrus only because the acidity in the citrus, but if it's once a week maximum, I do feed a blueberry, a couple blueberries, a couple tart cherries, a couple ra dark blackberries, raspberries, strawberries. They get a weekly fruit treat. Maybe a quarter strawberry, two blueberries. So they do get that. It's just good for them. There's the sugar count, so you have to be careful, but you can feed like raspberries low in sugar. And then there's the water count. Could lead to a little bit of diarrhea, which is okay because bearded dragons will poop and pee out any excess water inside their system. That's natural. It doesn't mean that they're unhealthy. It's a natural thing that they do, so that's okay. Prepared diets. Bearded dragon pelleted food moistened with water may be offered daily. This is a horrible statement. This is a horrible statement. Because you have to look at that bearded dragon food. If it's bearded dragon food that contains fish meal, you're going to screw your bearded dragon. So bad for them, that fish meal. Look it up. Fish meal and bearded dragons, it will kill them. Water. Clean daily, provided at all times. Yes, if you have water. You don't need water, but if you have water, you do need to clean it daily, assuming they go in it. If no one drinks it and they stay away, you don't need to. And if you provide it, you can provide it. You don't need to provide it at all times. It is a little bit more critical for babies, because sometimes they don't eat as much, so they don't get as much water from the food. But as adults, you don't need to provide it at all time. The diet can cover the water. When should I contact a veterinarian? In addition to regularly scheduling appointments, contact if runny droppings for two. You know, guys, these are tough things. Because, like, increased basking time, avoidance of basking area. There are so many things that don't, like, these two don't need a vet. This may not need a vet. This you should probably look at. I would just say this. If you haven't had bearded dragons or many reptiles and you really don't know the signs to know if they're healthy or unhealthy or having a problem, it's better to be safe than sorry. Someone who's an experienced keeper, if I see my guys basking for an hour more a day, I know there's nothing wrong with them. It's okay. On the back is like your shopping list, right? It's the shopping checklist, and it's going to tell you what you need. I do tell you, it's interesting because they want to make sure that everything that you need is something that they sell. So, you know, like, oh, I'm buying a bearded dragon today. I got my pamphlet. Let me check off everything. 10 to 20 gallon terrarium or larger, adults require at least 40. Yeah, I would say 40 is the smallest you could have them in. 50 is more comfortable. But if you do 40 correctly, you can set it up different, especially if you set up more than one story. You know, people poop. You know, I would say the S word here, but, you know, this is family friendly. People poop on the 40-gallon tanks. But, man, I've seen some 40 gallons where they've built a second level, and that's great. Because, you know, bearded dragons are not arboreal, guys. They don't climb. So if you build second levels or platforms to put a basking platform or a water bowl on, because then they have a cave under the platform and then they can go up top to drink, you really increase your space and you can get away easily with that. Screen lid. I say this, I laugh because, like, Archimedes doesn't have a screen lid. It's completely wide open. Johnny Cage doesn't have a screen lid. It's completely wide open. This is probably better for, like, babies and stuff that will jump out and run around. But, yeah, I guess to be safe, get a terrarium that's front opening and that's naturally there. UVB bulb and fixture. Yes, super important. I'm glad how they put it on the checklist near the top when they don't really mention it as necessity. They just mentioned it as it's something that can help. Like, mention it as a necessity. So here it is on the chart. Basking bulb and lamp. Yeah. Doesn't necessarily need to be a bulb. And this could be an MVB. This could be a ceramic heat emitter. This could be a halogen. But you still would need something to put those things in the lamp fixture or the dome. And then you could get more advanced. Now, at PetSmart, you saw, guys, they do sell mercury vapor bulbs and things. So maybe, hopefully, you have a knowledgeable associate there that could go over the options with you. Thermometers, hygrometer. Yeah, I don't use these, you know, because I measure the room humidity that they're in, and there's nothing going on in their tanks, and their tanks have airflow. And the thermometers, I use, so with this, I do use a probe, but I do spot. You got to really use a laser and spot temp the basking. Food bowl, water bowl, yeah, that's fine. Now they say artificial or natural. Rock or wood, that's fine. If you're doing natural, you got to make sure you disinfect it, especially if it's wood. Could have bugs in it, mites, parasites, etc. Bake the wood, soak it in bleach, then let it dry out. There's a lot of options. Or buy fake. Branches and plants, yeah, that's fine. Oh, reptile carpet substrate, no. Get rid of that. It's interesting that they put hide here because they talk about here a wood hiding spot, rock or wood hiding spot, but then they put a hide. Basically a tunnel or a cave, something for them to go in. Bearded dragon pellet food, I'd take this off. Live crickets, dubia roaches, and mealworms. Yeah, I mean, if you're not going to have a colony of these, I wouldn't buy too many. Calcium powder, yeah, that's fine. And then here's all your Vet Assure, blah, blah, blah. PetSmart Promise, you guys can read this if you want. But basically, if you buy a pet and it dies within 2 weeks, you can return it. Same thing with, like, fish and stuff, so it's pretty good. This is common for what you guys to look at because, like, anyone who sells to PetSmart, they have to do certain things here that make sure that they're not selling, like, a parasite thing. So what do I rate this? That's probably the big question. And, you know, these are going to probably be one of my longer series of videos when I go. That's why I'm going to do these one at a time. What would I rate this? This overall thing. You know, it's not horrible. It's not great, but it's not horrible. I do have a problem though. The biggest problem I have is there's some bad information in here. Not a lot, but there's some potentially life-threatening bad things. The reptile carpet. The reptile carpet, and they list it right here. 'Cause on the front it says reptile carpet or tile. But on the back they list reptile carpet substrate. That's horrible. And it just makes me want to invalidate this whole thing. Because someone who doesn't know, they'll get this and they'll build this. And I've seen this, and I've rescued bearded dragons, and I've seen urate here or urate stains. So the physical piece of urate is gone, but the stain is there. The information that's accurate in here is accurate, but the information that's wrong is wrong. Isn't that like an oxymoron, right? Like, of course, let's say a more truer statement. You know, PetSmart, and you guys had a vet do this. This approximately 10 years, that's a joke. That's a joke. Reptile carpet, a picture of it, listed here, talked about here, listed on the back, that's a joke. The vitamin D3 powder, that's not good. The bearded dragon pellets, that's not good. The vegetables, freshly, not listing, and specifically listing carrots. I know that this is supposed to be a simple when you buy, you know, bearded dragon thing. It's not an expert thing, but I would not pass this. I would fail. This would get an F. You know, there's light. There's a few sections that would kill your bearded dragon. I'm gonna go buy them the Fluker's bearded dragon buffet meal. It's right there on the shelf. Oh. Number one ingredient, fish meal. That bearded dragon's dead, or it's messed up for its whole life. I'm gonna overload it with D3, but it's got a strong UV bulb. Dead. They don't mention measuring the UVB. They don't mention a type of laser temp gun to actually measure the basking spot to get accurate temperatures. Yeah. You know, if you built this right here, how would you know what that basking spot is? That's the closest little thermometer, and that's useless. That's not going to measure the basking spot. This gets an F, unfortunately. I'm going to grade them on a scale of A through F. This gets a giant failure. It has a little bit of good information, but the bad information it has, in my opinion, is so bad and is life-threatening. It gets an F. That's unfortunate. Come on, PetSmart. Work with some, I don't know who your vets are that, you know, does this, and I'm sure they're salesmen as well because of selling this, but work with some people who've kept bearded dragons who have lived over 20 years, you know, who have lived over 16, 17 years. They don't follow this, and they've been healthy for those years. They don't follow this. All right, everyone, take care. I'll see you in the next review. I think I'm going to pump out these reviews. And I think what you'll see is maybe, I don't know, maybe every Sunday for the next couple while, you're going to get one of these. And on Saturday, even though this is coming out on Saturday, but on Saturdays, you'll actually get a video with my reptiles. Yeah, that might be a good break until these run out. And then the reptiles will come back. And maybe we'll see a reptile guest. I don't know. We'll see because, you know, I have tarantulas. I have these. I have this. 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 You know, there's got some of this. Got this. Don't have this. Oh, look, Redfoot gets its own. So we'll see. We'll see. Oh, look at the skink one. It's like much more legit. All right. Take care, everybody. Thank you guys for supporting my reptile rescue family.